Welcome to this video on the Bible, It Is Written. My name is Patrick Voss. If you've ever had questions about how the Bible came to us, was transmitted over time, and preserved, I hope this presentation answers any of your questions or doubts. Many people don't realize that the Bible is not just one book, it's a compilation of 66 books in one. These books were written over 1,600 years, in several different continents, in three different languages, and 40 different authors. The authors of the Bible weren't sages, gurus, or so-called perfected beings like we see from other religions. No, the biblical authors were sinners like you and me, saved by God's grace, who came from the most diverse walks of life. They were prophets, kings, sheep herders, tax collectors, fishermen, and a doctor. These authors were separated from each other by hundreds of years, hundreds of miles, different continents, and different languages. Yet, God brought them all together in one book. The Bible has diverse literature and diverse topics. We find perfect unity in the message the Bible conveys. The Bible portrays the relationship between God and man from creation to Adam and Eve's fall in the garden and God's judgment on sin, to His promised Messiah, Jesus' saving work for man, to the founding of the Christian church, and it projects this relationship ahead to the end of time. The Bible is the world's all-time best-selling and most widely circulated book in history. The United Bible Societies alone distributes annually 500 million scriptures. At the start of the 19th century, scriptures were available in just 68 languages. Today, it's over 3,000. That means well over 90% of the world's population has access to God's Word. The Old Testament contains 39 books and was written approximately between 1500 and 400 BC. The New Testament contains 27 books and was written approximately between AD 45 and 96. The Bible was written on stone, clay, leather, papyrus, and parchments. When it comes to Old Testament Bible copying, Jewish Masoretic scribes counted the number of words and even the number of letters in an entire book. They determined what would be the middle word, letter, or verse, and used it as a reference point. If the count was incorrect, the whole manuscript was destroyed, not corrected. Prior to 1947, the Masoretic text was the main manuscript used to translate the Old Testament. This text is a complete Old Testament manuscript dated from AD 1008, prepared and preserved by the Jewish Masoretic scribes. In 1947, an Arabian shepherd boy named Muhammad stumbled across the Dead Sea Scrolls while searching for a lost goat. As he threw a stone, he heard the breaking of a clay vessel. Upon investigation, he found the entrance to a cave that contained a veritable treasure known to the world as the Dead Sea Scrolls. The carefully sealed jars had preserved the leather scrolls for 2,000 years. These scrolls were placed there by the Essenes, a Jewish religious sect which began their own monastic community in the Judean desert near Qumran. The Dead Sea Scrolls were found in 11 Qumran caves between 1947 and 1956. The scrolls dated between 300 BC and 100 AD. The more than 800 manuscripts included every book of the Old Testament except Esther. Among these ancient finds were two complete manuscripts of the book of Isaiah dated to 125 BC. Remember, previous to this, the Masoretic text was the main manuscript used to translate the Old Testament. But now with this find, we're able to see how God had preserved His Word over an 1,100-year time frame. The manuscript from 1000 AD and the Isaiah scrolls from 125 BC matched up almost word for word in more than 95% of the text. Respected evangelical author Gleason Archer writes, "The 5% variation consisted chiefly of obvious slips of the pen and variations in spelling." The Shrine of the Book in Jerusalem houses the famous Dead Sea Scrolls today. Portions of the famous scrolls are also displayed in exhibits across the world. The surviving copies of the New Testament writings has a multiplicity of manuscripts. The existing Greek manuscripts total almost 6,000. The surviving Greek New Testament manuscripts include extant papyri manuscripts dated between AD 100 and 699. Since papyrus is very perishable, only 127 papyrus fragments have been found so far, and all come from Egypt, where the dry climate makes survival possible. The uncial manuscripts are somewhat like our capital letters, with no spacing between words or sentences. By the way, for those of you wondering where the verse chapter divisions and punctuation comes in. That was actually added to the text many centuries later. There are currently over 320 known Greek New Testament unsealed manuscripts dating between AD 300 and around 999. Minuscules are manuscripts written in small letters, commonly in a cursive or free-flowing hand. We have 2,900 of these manuscripts dated between AD 800 and 1599. Lectionaries are books that contain the Gospels and Epistles. These were to be read throughout the year in early Christian churches. Some 2,400 lectionaries have been discovered, and they date from the 6th century. This again gives us an impressive collection of Greek manuscripts. A fragment of just a verse or two still counts as a manuscript, and yet the average size for a New Testament manuscript is more than 450 pages. In addition to the 6,000 Greek manuscripts from the 2nd century on, we have 19,284 complete or partial manuscript copies of the New Testament in various languages. The list is quite impressive, as you can see, and more so when you consider ancient literature was rarely translated into another language, as Professor Greenlee points out. So if you add the Greek New Testament manuscripts to copies of the New Testament in various languages dating from AD 150, that's almost 25,000 surviving New Testament manuscripts for translators to draw from. All of the New Testament books were written by AD 100 and circulated in the churches. The early Christian church fathers quote from these New Testament writings. In fact, we have over 36,000 of these quotes in existence today, and we can reconstruct virtually the entire New Testament with these quotes. One of the test historians use to determine the authenticity of ancient documents is called the bibliographical test. This test looks at the length of time between the writing of the original and the writing of the existing copies. For example, Homer's Iliad, written in 800 BC, has an impressive 1,700 copies extant today. We don't have the original, but the earliest copies we have are 400 years after this ancient Greek epic poem was written. Plato is taught in college classrooms across the world with little if any skepticism to its authenticity, yet we have only 210 copies of Plato, and the earliest copies come an astounding 1,300 years after Plato's writings. Keep these numbers in mind. Plato's student Aristotle's manuscripts exist of only 3, and the earliest copies we have are 1,400 years after he first penned them. Herodotus published his account of the Greco-Persian Wars. Since then, scholars have been using this Greek historian's historical analysis for 2,500 years. Yet we have only 8 copies of his writings, coming some 1,300 years after he first wrote them. Pliny the Younger, a magistrate of ancient Rome, wrote hundreds of letters that historians used to document things like the eruption of Vesuvius in AD 79. But we have only 7 copies of his writings that come 750 years after he originally wrote them. Tacitus was a famous 1st century Roman historian. Without his writings, much of what modern-day historians know about ancient Rome would be lacking. Yet there's only 20 extant copies of his writings, and copies come 1,000 years after he first wrote them. Keep in mind, we have no originals of the above examples. Yet historians consider manuscript copies we have for these writers true to the originals. Now let's look at the New Testament, which was written in the 1st century between approximately AD 45 and 96. The New Testament doesn't have just a handful of copies in the Greek original, but almost 6,000. And the time span between when the originals were penned and the surviving copies we have is not 400, 750, or 1,400 years, but 21 to 72 years. The Old Testament likewise has over 1,000 copies, and the veracity of its manuscripts have been proven by the finding of the Dead Sea Scrolls. John Warwick Montgomery writes, "To be skeptical of the resultant text of the New Testament books is to allow all of classic antiquity to slip into obscurity, for no documents of the ancient period are as well attested bibliographically as the New Testament." If we were to take all the copies of the works of an average Greek author, they would stack up 4 feet high. In comparison, if we were to add the almost 6,000 New Testament manuscripts with the over 19,000 versions of different languages, the copies of the New Testament would stack up over a mile high. New Testament author F.F. Bruce writes, "If the New Testament were a collection of secular writings, their authenticity would generally be regarded as beyond all doubt. It's a curious fact that historians have often been much readier to trust the New Testament records than many theologians." What about the original manuscripts? As we've seen, we have over 1,000 Old Testament copies. New Testament copies, including Greek and other language translations, are near 25,000. But we admit we don't have the original Bible manuscripts. As we've mentioned, we don't have the originals of any ancient manuscripts. But if we did have the original scriptures of both Testaments, who would control them? Would, for example, the Vatican have control of the New Testament? Orthodox Jews, the Old Testament? How could we be sure that alterations, deletions, or additions would not be made? That's obviously happened in the case of other non-Christian religions who claim to have original scriptures. The Old and New Testament copies are located in various libraries, universities, religious institutions, and government locales in over 200 places across the world and not controlled by one governing body or institution. There are even manuscripts owned by individuals. Now we come to the important field of textual criticism. Many who are quick to claim the biblical transmission can't be trusted have little, if any, knowledge what this field of scholarly study is all about. Many consider Dan Wallace Christianity's premier active textual critic today. He runs the Center for the Study of New Testament Manuscripts. So, what is textual criticism? The discipline that attempts to determine the original wording of any documents whose original no longer exists. Something Dan Wallace and others have devoted many man-hours to. Many uncritically claim it's impossible to get back to the originals. Why? Because they've heard, or just assumed, the Bible was transmitted in a linear fashion. Aha, they say. Because errors crept into the copying process, they deduce the original writing has been forever lost. But the Bible didn't come to us by a single line of transmission, but a multiple line. This is a key point to remember. Another misconception we hear from people is the Bible is like the old telephone game. As it gets passed down from one person to another, the story allegedly changes. But again, the Bible did not undergo a linear line of transmission, but a multiple transmission spread throughout the biblical world, making the telephone game argument no more than an urban myth. Dan Wallace writes, "The textual critic doesn't rely on just the last person in the transmissional line, but can interrogate many scribes over the centuries, way back to the second century." So this is the wrong way of looking at the biblical transmission. A multiple line with almost 6,000 Greek manuscripts allows us to get back to the original, as we shall see. We also admit that it's true that variants have crept into the manuscripts, but we will also see how that's not a problem. After the New Testament was written, copies started to be made by trained scribes and untrained scribes. Over the next several centuries, variants inevitably crept in. So, what's a variant? Any place where any manuscript differs from any other manuscript, like spelling differences, a word left out, or an extra word inserted. Here's an example of a word left out. Let's say the original was only Son of God. As you can see, most of the manuscripts have faithfully copied this phrase correctly. But one copyist mistakenly left out the word only, and it was subsequently copied that way in the manuscript tradition. If we could isolate this one manuscript line and see how it differs from all the others, could we be confident what the original said? The answer is yes. Only Son of God. Another example is how extra words are inserted. When textual critics look at the earliest manuscripts of Romans 1:16, they say, "I am not ashamed of the gospel." But later manuscripts, hundreds of years later, say, "I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ." Again, if we isolate this one manuscript line and see how it differs from all the others, we can see how a later pious scribe likely added the phrase of Christ. By the way, does adding of Christ drastically change the meaning of the text? Certainly not. Dan Wallace says the variants can be categorized into four kinds: spelling and nonsense readings. For example, in the minuscule Greek manuscript number 109, dated to the 14th century, an apparently sleepy scribe was copying the genealogy in Luke chapter 3, which of the text he was copying from was in two vertical columns. Instead of copying the names in vertical columns as they appeared in his master copy, he copied them across the columns horizontally. The result was that everyone had the wrong father. God was the son of Aram. Correcting the manuscript was very easy, though, because of the thousands of correct manuscripts in existence. A spelling example, the name John in Greek can be spelled with two N's or one N. In 2 Peter 1:1, several manuscripts say, "Simeon Peter, a slave and apostle." Other extant manuscripts read, "Simon Peter, a slave and apostle." Spelling and nonsense readings are the vast majority, accounting for at least 75% of all variants. Another category is differences that don't affect translation or that involve synonyms. For example, Greek can use or not use the definite article for proper nouns such as Mary or the Mary. There are meaningful variants that are not viable. Dan Wallace explains. One manuscript from the 10th-11th century lacks the words "on account of the Son of Man." That's a very meaningful variant since it seems to say that a person is blessed when he is persecuted, regardless of his allegiance to Christ. Yet, it's only in one manuscript, and a relatively late one at that. It has no chance of reflecting the wording of the original text, since all the other manuscripts are against it, including quite a few that are much, much earlier. So indeed, this one manuscript variant sticks out like a sore thumb. One of many people's most memorable Bible stories is Jesus and the Stoning of the Adulterous Woman. But the earliest manuscripts with substantial portions of John's Gospel lack these verses. The oldest, largest codices of the Bible also lack these verses. Codex Sinaiticus and Vaticanus from the 4th century and Codex Alexandrinus from the 5th century. Mark 16:9-20 also does not appear in some of the oldest existing witnesses. This is the section where the apostles are told to pick up snakes. While these meaningful variants comprise less than 1% of all textual variants, no cardinal belief is at stake, Dan Wallace writes. They don't jeopardize essential beliefs. Many of you will also know that we have footnotes in our Bibles for these passages telling us that the earliest manuscripts do not have these verses. So, spelling errors consist of about 75% of the variants. And again, the meaningful and viable variants are less than 1%. I now want to share with you a survey I did at several different churches. Remember the uncial texts? I presented groups at three different churches with an uncial text of Romans chapter 10, verses 1 through 4 in English. These groups consisted of 10 to 16 people, and the results were the same at all three churches. I gave each person a piece of paper with this passage in uncial form, the letters all together with no spacing. Most people copied it verbatim like these two. Several people made simple mistakes, like leaving a letter out of a word. Others wrote the same word twice. Others added letters, transposed letters, and left a letter out. Others put do instead of did. As you can see, these are insignificant variants. Let's say I lost my original uncial text of Romans 10. 10 of 16 in my survey copied it verbatim. Despite the six insignificant variants among the others, could we know what the original said? No doubt. We could get back to the original with justifiable confidence. And the same is the case for the text of the New Testament. Now that we've explained the variants in the text, how many variants do you think the New Testament text has? By the way, there are 138,000 words in the New Testament. Scholars estimate up to 400,000 variants. But before you look so shocked, remember most of these are spelling differences, a word left out, or an extra word inserted. Bart Ehrman, who claims to have once been a Christian and is now an atheist historian scholar, makes a big deal out of this, saying there are up to three times as many variants than there are words in the New Testament. But the liberal media that loves to quote him never tells you in his most honest moments, Ehrman admits, the more manuscripts one discovers, the more the variant readings. But also, the more likelihood that somewhere among those variant readings, one will be able to uncover the original text. Even Ehrman admitted in the appendix to his popular book, Misquoting Jesus, essential Christian beliefs are not affected by textual variants in the manuscript tradition of the New Testament. We agree. The fact is that 99% of the variants hold virtually no significance whatsoever. And if 99% of the variants are insignificant, in reality, we're talking about only one variant for every three pages of the New Testament. Ron Rhodes concludes, really, when all the facts are put on the table, only about 50 of the variants have any real significance. And even then, no doctrine of the Christian faith or any moral commandments is affected by them. For more than 99% of the cases, the original text can be reconstructed to a practical certainty. B.B. Warfield writes, at first, the great multitude of variants would seem to be a liability to the integrity of the Bible text. But just the contrary is true, for the larger number of variants supplies at the same time the means of checking on those variants. As strange as it may appear, the corruption of the text provides the means for its own correction. So even though there are variants in the manuscript tradition, textual critics can put them under the microscope and see that 99% of them are so insignificant as just to leave them where they are without any effect on us getting back to what the original text said. James White adds, "I believe that the presence of variants in the New Testament text is God's way of having preserved His Word. The fact that there are variants in the text actually provides us with the means of correcting human error. The fact that we can look and see what kind of errors are made, the fact that the text comes to us from all over Europe, Palestine, North Africa, and gives us different perspectives and different families of manuscripts that are related to one another, that is what gives us the ability to arrive at the original reading." Once again, think about how all the manuscripts were spread out over the known world, precluding wholesale changes. We often hear silly objections from New Age gurus like actress Shirley MacLaine, who claims the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD took out reincarnation from the Bible. Well, in order for someone to pull that off, they would have had to search out and erase this alleged doctrine out of all the manuscripts. This is not even remotely a possibility. James White states, "No one at any time could have simply come along, gathered up all the manuscripts, and made wholesale changes. You see, if all we had was simply one text that was produced by one group in one place, we would have no way of knowing if that was what was originally written or not, because we would not be able to answer the question, well, how do you know in 700 AD they didn't decide to change the whole theological structure and edit everything they didn't like out? They couldn't. There's no way they ever could have gathered up all the manuscripts to do it." By the way, that's exactly what an early Islamic leader did with the Quran. Faced with the problem of different Muslim communities using different versions of the Quran, the third Muslim caliph Uthman, who came to power in 644, declared the collection of Zayd ibn Thabit, one of Muhammad's most trusted secretaries, to be the official version. Several copies of this new official version of the Quran were sent to each major center of the Islamic Empire. Uthman then ordered all other copies collected and burned so there could be no challenge to the new authorized text. You see, the very existence of so many variant readings in the biblical manuscripts allows us to recover what the original must have said with a great degree of confidence. By contrast, it's impossible to restore the Quran to what existed prior to Uthman, since we now have only one version of the Quran, the one Uthman wanted us to have. By the time anyone did attain great ecclesiastical power in the name of Christianity, texts like P66 or P75 were already long buried in the sands of Egypt, out of the reach of anyone who would try to alter them. These papyri were buried in the sands of Egypt for some 1,800 years before being discovered only in the past 100 years. Over 100 surviving papyrus fragments have been discovered since that time. 127 papyri manuscripts dating between AD 100 and 699 have been discovered. They all come from Egypt, where the dry climate makes survival possible. The earliest known copy of any portion of the New Testament is known as P52, which contains several sentences from John's Gospel. Scholars have dated this fragment in the first half of the 2nd century. Because this fragment was located in Egypt, this shows that the Gospel of John was circulated a significant distance within 30 years of its traditional place of composition of Asia Minor, meaning it would be fair to say this fragment could be from the end of the 1st century. The P52 papyri belongs to the John Rylands Library in Manchester, England. Currently, we have over 60 extant manuscripts from the 2nd and 3rd centuries, with more being found every year. In fact, Dan Wallace points out, with these discoveries, we're getting closer and closer to the original manuscripts every year, not farther and farther away, as skeptics would have us believe. Significant uncials have also been discovered in codex or book form. Codex Vaticanus, dated from the 4th century, is the oldest uncial on parchment or vellum and contains most of the Old and New Testaments. It's considered as one of the most trustworthy manuscripts of the New Testament text. Codex Sinaiticus, also from the 4th century, contains half of the Old Testament and all of the New, with the exception of Mark 16:9-20 and John 7:53-8:11. Codex Alexandrinus, from the 5th century, contains almost the entire Bible. Hundreds of other uncial codex manuscripts dating from the 3rd to the 15th century are stored at libraries across the world. Christian apologist Rob Bowman describes the condition of our manuscript witnesses as being like a 1,000-piece jigsaw puzzle with extra pieces. Bowman writes, "It's not that we don't have the original text, it's just that we have to figure out which ones are the extras." Imagine having this treasure trove of manuscripts where the original is certainly in there. Now we just have to put the puzzle together. And again, the textual critics are able to decipher what those extra pieces are. So much so that we can put the puzzle together to get back to the original. So the next time you hear someone claim the Bible came to us through a process like the telephone game, you can correct them, pointing out that the manuscript transmission was not a single line, but a multiple line, and that the manuscript tradition is so strong that we actually can be confident we have the original pieces and more. Let's take a look at one last popular objection brought up by Bart Ehrman. We don't have the originals. First, when Ehrman claims that we don't have the originals, it's important to note that he's saying we don't have the physical original text in existence that the New Testament authors penned. As we said earlier, he's correct. But again, we also don't have the physical originals of any ancient document. But the real issue is not whether we have the physical original New Testament text extant, but whether we have a sufficient number and quality of manuscripts to reconstruct the original, and as we have seen, we clearly do. New Testament scholar Michael Kruger states, the autographs contain the original text, but the original text can exist without them. While it's true the physical original text the New Testament authors penned no longer exist, they live on and do exist in copies of the manuscript tradition. Even with the hundreds of thousands of variants, the original text still exists in the manuscript tradition. Dr. Kruger adds, even though we do not possess the autographs, textual scholars have acknowledged that the multiplicity of manuscripts allows us to access the original text. The president of the Society of Biblical Literature, Eldon J. Epp, notes, the point is that we have so many manuscripts of the New Testament that surely the original reading, in every case, is somewhere present in our vast store of material. Gordon Fee, considered a leading expert in textual criticism of the New Testament, concurs. The immense amount of material available to New Testament textual critics is their good fortune, because with such an abundance of material, one can be reasonably certain that the original text is to be found somewhere in it. Yet Ehrman remains well aware that textual critics can, in his words, reconstruct the oldest form of the words of the New Testament with reasonable, though not 100% accuracy. Ehrman, despite being an honest textual critic at times, loves to fan the flames by claiming, we don't have the first copies of the originals. He says, we don't even have copies of the copies of the originals. Or copies of the copies of the copies of the originals. What we have are copies made later, much later. Ehrman goes on, in most instances, they are copies made many centuries later. Is the situation really that blight? We say Ehrman is putting forth a worst-case scenario that really isn't fair to the history and the reliability of the transmission of the New Testament text. For example, we know right after the originals were penned, they were to be read in the churches. Paul, writing the letter to the Thessalonians from Corinth, said, I put you under oath before the Lord to have this letter read to all the brothers. This was a general command Paul likely gave for all his letters. Paul wrote his letter to the Colossians from a prison cell, likely in Rome. He told the Colossians, and when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans. Paul's three missionary journeys were also an opportunity for the churches to copy his letters. As the Apostle Paul, who wrote 13 New Testament letters, made personal visits to many churches. During the mid-60s, Peter, writing most likely from Rome, indicates that there was already a collection of Paul's letters at the time. He, Paul, writes the same way in all his letters, speaking in them of these matters. His letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort as they do the other scriptures to their own destruction. Paul's 13 letters that Peter described as scripture had already been circulated throughout the Christian world by around AD 65. In Mark 14:9, Jesus said that wherever the gospel is proclaimed, that stories like the woman pouring perfume on his head at Bethany would be told in the whole world. The gospel was copied and disseminated throughout the biblical world where the accounts of Jesus were told. The Apostle John, writing the book of Revelation from the island of Patmos, was told, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And what you see, write in the book and send it to the seven churches, which are in Asia, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamum, to Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. And while this circulation was happening throughout the Christian world, the New Testament books are being received with joy. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, "We also thank God continually because when you received the Word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the Word of men, but as it actually is the Word of God, which is at work in you who believe." The Christians in various churches copied these letters and distributed them to other Christians. The churches who had received the letters then shared copies with each other. Gradually, the epistles became circulated within the first century New Testament church and were often read during services at churches throughout the known world. With the New Testament well established in the Christian world before the end of the first century, church fathers were quoting from the Gospels. Clement was a bishop at the Church of Rome in the first century. He wrote a letter to the Corinthian church in which he refers to passages from the Gospel of Matthew. In his letters, Clement also quoted Romans, 1 Corinthians, Hebrews, James, 1 Peter, 1 Timothy, and Titus. Polycarp, a disciple of the Apostle John, quoted 15 New Testament books in AD 108. Ignatius of Antioch quoted from 7 New Testament books in AD 115. And church fathers from the 2nd and 3rd centuries all quoted extensively from New Testament books. And as we mentioned previously, we have these quotes in existence today, and we can compile the New Testament for most of these quotes alone. The Didache manuscript, dated as early as AD 70, a handbook for new Christian converts and a manual of church order and practice, uses Matthew and Luke extensively and shows familiarity with the rest of the New Testament. In addition, as mentioned earlier, despite what skeptics like Ehrman say, we do have early copies of the New Testament in existence today. P52, an early portion of the Gospel of John, has been dated to AD 117. But since P52 was discovered hundreds of miles from where John originally penned his gospel, and thus had to travel, some scholars have dated this fragment to the end of the first century. And as we mentioned before, currently we have over 60 extant New Testament manuscripts from the 2nd and 3rd centuries. Bart Ehrman makes a big deal out of suggesting that by the 2nd century, the originals and reliable copies had all but disappeared. But there are several places that address whether the originals survive into the 2nd century and possibly beyond. Tertullian, writing in AD 180, said, "Come now, you who would indulge a better curiosity, if you would apply to the business of your salvation, run over to the apostolic churches in which the very thrones of the apostles are still preeminent in their places, in which their own authentic writings are read, uttering the voice and representing the face of each of them severally." Tertullian goes on to discuss each of these authentic writings as being found in the very churches to which they were written. He mentions Corinth, Philippi, Thessalonica, Ephesus, and Rome. He urges his readers to visit these sites to check out these authentic writings. Dan Wallace comments on Tertullian's amazing 2nd century statement. This seems to suggest that he believed that these documents were the autographs. Wallace added, "In the least, it suggests that by his day, carefully done copies of the originals were considered important for verifying what the apostles meant, and such copies had a strong connection to the churches to which they were originally written. One still has to wonder why Tertullian focuses on the very churches which received the originals, if he didn't mean by the comment that these churches still preserved the autographs." Despite some scholars saying Tertullian likely meant copies when he said their own authentic writings, Dan Wallace says, "My sense, however, both from the context and from lexical usage, is that Tertullian meant the autographa." Peter, the bishop of Alexandria, who died in the last year of the Diocletian persecution in AD 311, speaks of the autograph of the Gospel of John as still existing in his day. In fragment one of his writings, he speaks of the autograph of John's Gospel. "The copy itself, that was written by the hand of the evangelist, which by the divine grace has been preserved in the most holy church of Ephesus, and is there adored by the faithful." Another key point, early Christians considered the Word of God to be so important that many died to protect it. For example, in AD 303, the Roman Emperor Diocletian ordered that all Christian scripture be destroyed. While some Christians complied with the emperor's order, many suffered torture and martyrdom to protect God's Word. Many Christians who refused to turn over their sacred writings were seized, severely tortured, and then burned alive. 4th century church historian Eusebius writes that prisons were filled with Christian leaders. Many were killed, being burned alive. Others lost limbs, eyes, and ears. But what is certain is that these Christians believed in the protection of God's word, so much so that many suffered and even died to make sure we have the scriptures. After Diocletian's persecution failed, the reaction against those Christians who had turned over scripture to the Romans from other Christians was so strong that it caused a controversy within the church for many years after. In fact, it was so strong that a new word entered into our vocabulary. Those who turned over the word of God were called those who delivered, which in Latin is traditores. It has come into English as traitors. Following centuries of persecution against the Christian church, Christianity was declared legal throughout the Roman Empire with the Edict of Milan in AD 313. Persecution would stop, and churches and other properties would be returned to Christians. After AD 313, scriptoriums were used to record copies of the New Testament. Several trained scribes would each write a copy of the text as it was read by a lector or reader. The lector would read from a master document. In this way, several copies could be made at once. Manuscripts were then reviewed by a corrector who was trained to rectify mistakes. One of the most important church fathers, Jerome, who maintained his own personal scriptorium and staff of scribes in the 4th century, wrote, "You who will transcribe this book, I charge you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of his glorious second coming, in which he will come to judge the living and the dead, compare what you have copied against the original and correct it carefully. Furthermore, transcribe this adjuration and place it in the copy." This is more evidence refuting Bart Ehrman's theory that all the originals were gone by the second century. So Ehrman's hyper-skepticism is not valid, as the manuscript history shows that some of the original writings likely lived on through the 4th century. Church fathers as early as late in the 1st century were quoting from New Testament books. We also have dozens of manuscripts from the 2nd and 3rd centuries, with more being found every year. And during this time, many Christians died to protect the scriptures. So while we agree with Bart Ehrman that the originals are no longer in existence, the same cannot be said for the manuscript tradition that derives from the originals. As we have seen, the biblical manuscript tradition has a veracity about it unlike any other text of ancient literature. In our next section, we'll discuss Bible translations. The Old Testament was authored in Hebrew and Aramaic. The New Testament in Greek. Many uncritically claim that the Bible is a copy of a copy of a copy, suggesting that each copy borrows from the previous copy in the translation stage, or implying that each copy was somehow discarded after it was completed. But this is false, as the copies were not discarded but actually went into the manuscript tradition line. And today's translation process is directly from the Hebrew and Greek manuscripts derived from the manuscript tradition line. Keep in mind that the extant Hebrew and Greek manuscripts are always the final authority. A translation is from the original language into a receptor language, for example, from Hebrew manuscripts into German or Greek into English. Earlier we talked about the Hebrew manuscripts. How do translators have access to them? They're collated in a book called Biblia Hebraica Stuttgartensia. This book is a copy of the Masoretic text as recorded in the Leningrad Codex. How do translators have access to the Greek manuscripts? They are collated in this book, which is the Nestle-Aland Critical Text. The first edition was published in 1898, and the 28th edition came out in late 2012. This is the standard scholarly edition of the Greek New Testament used by scholars, Bible translators, professors, students, and pastors worldwide. Likewise, the United Bible Society's Greek New Testament contains the same base text. The almost 6,000 surviving New Testament manuscripts are collated into the text of the UBS and the NA28. So, how are our Bibles really translated? from the surviving Hebrew and Greek manuscripts that have been made available to teams of translation scholars through these books. For those of you who have been taught that the Bible is simply a copy of a copy of a copy, well, now you know better, when in fact our Bibles are translated from the surviving Hebrew and Greek manuscripts, which have been carefully collated for us by textual scholars. We now come to another important area, the canon of Scripture. The word canon means measuring rod, rule, or standard. When the Church speaks of the canon of Scripture, it's speaking of the standard in which it measures and evaluates whether something is true or right and from God. F.F. Bruce writes, "The historic Christian belief is that the Holy Spirit, who controlled the individual writings of the books, also controlled their selection and collection, thus continuing to fulfill our Lord's promise that He would guide His disciples into all truth." Here's an important concept. While God is the author of the biblical canon, man discovers what God has already determined. God guided the canon process all the way in both the Old and the New Testaments. We must ask this question: did God have a purpose for giving us His Scripture? The answer is in the Bible itself. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. His purpose is that the Bible teaches us the will of God via sound doctrine. Scripture reproofs, that is, it convinces men of the truth, and rebukes those who will deny it. Correction is always a necessary complement to any reproof. With a reproof, we see where we're wrong, while with the correction, we know what is the right thing to do. His purpose is also that we may be trained in righteousness, in holy living, in conformity to God's will, in thought, purpose, and action, so that the man of God may be equipped for every good work. In order for God to equip us for every good work, teaching sound doctrine, reproofing, correcting, and training in righteousness, it necessarily follows that He would have to equip us with all of His Word. If He hasn't, how could we be equipped for every good work? If God promises to equip us for every good work, He's going to give us the complete instruction book to do it, and indeed, He has. The fact is that God's Church has been equipped for every good work through the ages, and His purpose has been and is being fulfilled through our possession of the canon. The canon is a very part of redemptive history. Imagine, if you will, that the body of Christ is like a ship. How has that ship been guided through the ages? What good would a ship be without a rudder? The canon of Scripture is that rudder that has guided the body of Christ through the ages and is guiding it today. When we speak of the canon, John Calvin states, "God alone is a witness of Himself and His Word. Scripture is indeed self-authenticated." The Jewish Tanakh, or Old Testament canon, consisted of three divisions: the Law, the Prophets, and the Writings. Jesus confirmed this division or canon when He said, "Everything must be fulfilled that is written about Me in the Law of Moses, the Prophets, and the Psalms," the Psalms being part of the Writings. In addition, the Jewish canon starts with Genesis and ends with Chronicles. This is significant because Jesus recognized this Hebrew structure of Scripture or canon when He said, "From the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, who was killed between the altar and the sanctuary." Abel was the first martyr recorded in the Hebrew canon. Zechariah was the last. Jesus was bookending the Hebrew canon and thus confirming everything in between. When we look back at the early church, we can see how they recognized God's self-authenticated Word. Unless a book could be shown to come from the pen of an apostle, or at least to have the authority of an apostle behind it, it was rejected. The Gospels of Matthew and John, Paul's 13 letters, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and Revelation were all written by apostles. The book of Acts and the Gospel of Luke were written by one of the apostles' most trusted and beloved friends and traveling companion, Luke, an historian and physician. The Gospel of Mark was written by John Mark, a traveling companion of Paul and a scribe for the apostle Peter. The book of James was written by James, who was a witness to the resurrection and someone Paul called a pillar of the church. The book of Jude was written by Jude, whom Scripture calls a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. Finally, the book of Hebrews, while we're not sure of the author, the writer of Hebrews himself says in chapter 2 he was taught by the apostles. Secondly, were the books authentic? If they did not accord with the teaching of the Old Testament canon, it would have been rejected. Third, is it from the apostolic age? Many works were brought forth in the 2nd century and after that claimed to be written by apostles and their associates, but the early church fathers rejected these as canonical, as a close examination showed they certainly weren't. For example, many of these so-called Gospels came over a century or two after the actual apostles they are named after had died. There were Gnostic or secret teachings and sayings in these books that directly contradicted the New Testament. For example, that Jesus didn't die, or the resurrected Jesus tells his disciples he has put off his body of flesh. The Gospel of Peter from AD 150 had Jesus exiting his tomb led by a giant angel whose head stretched into the heavens and a talking cross saying, "Yea." The Gospel of Thomas from the late 2nd century, loved by liberal scholars, by the way, has Jesus saying that women must become men to enter the kingdom of heaven. Other books claim to be the Acts of John, Paul, or Thomas. For example, the Acts of Paul is dated from the late 2nd century, but we know Paul was beheaded around AD 67, so he couldn't have written this. This late 2nd century book has Paul baptizing a lion who is 18 feet tall. And other ancient books in the early church were read for their devotional value, but were not considered part of the canon. Finally, was it received by God's people? The church came to receive and recognize the 27 books of the New Testament over a period of time, as God chose to deliver his canonical books to his church through the normal historical channels. All of these 27 books were circulated and read in the churches and recognized as canonical, as the early church was guided by the Holy Spirit. Jesus said Old Testament writings were spoken by the Holy Spirit. He also said the same Holy Spirit would come to teach the apostles all truth, and that the Holy Spirit would teach them all things and bring all things to their memory. This promise was fulfilled when they spoke and later recorded everything Jesus had taught them in the New Testament. The canon was closed when the last New Testament book was written, late in the first century. J.I. Packer writes, "The church no more gave us the New Testament canon than Sir Isaac Newton gave us the force of gravity. God gave us gravity. Newton did not create gravity, but recognized it. The apostles didn't give us the resurrection, they discovered it. And so it is with the Bible. The church did not give us the canon, they discovered it. Why we have certainty of the canon is based upon God's purpose in giving us the Bible in the first place." My hope is everything that we've said up to this point would lead one to consider the Bible being a book that is inspired by God. When we say the Bible is inspired, we mean the Bible has a divine origin. The Bible itself says all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. The Greek word for inspired is theotustos, which literally means God breathed. The Old Testament explicitly states that it's conveying the express words of God. Over 3,000 times, the Bible says, "Thus saith the Lord," or "God says." While the Bible is inspired, God used human authors to convey His Word. God used their own individual personalities and recorded without error His revelation to man. The vocabulary was theirs, the message was God's, as they wrote under the control and guidance of the Holy Spirit. Just like our Lord Jesus Christ is both divine and human, the Scriptures are both divine and human. On the one hand, God wrote it. On the other hand, man wrote it. For example, Exodus 20:12 reads, "Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you." Who said that? According to Matthew 15:4, God said it, for God said, "Honor your father and mother." But according to Mark 7:10, Moses said it, for Moses said, "Honor your father and your mother." As the Chicago Statement on Inerrancy of the 1970s so appropriately stated, the belief that imperfect humans necessarily preclude an inerrant revelation is based primarily upon a rejection of God's sovereignty in human affairs. Other important terms are the inerrancy and infallibility of the Bible. The terms inerrancy and infallibility are often used interchangeably. While inerrancy contends that the Bible does not have any errors, infallibility means that the Bible is reliable and trustworthy in all that it teaches. Inerrancy applies to the original autographs, not to copies or translations of Scripture. But as we discussed earlier, textual scholars have shown we have great confidence in getting back to the originals. Up until the last few centuries, the historic Christian church has always held the Bible as being inspired, inerrant, and infallible. That is, until liberalism crept in. And that has led to millions of all ages to question the reliability of the Bible, if not openly, certainly in their private thoughts. But many of those same people will be quick to say, Jesus was a good teacher. If you're one of those people, consider this. Jesus expressed the highest view of the Old Testament. He accepted its divine authority, its imperishability, divine inspiration, unbreakability, supremacy, inerrancy, historical reliability, and scientific accuracy. Also in Luke chapter 4, Jesus stood up in front of the synagogue and read from a scroll of the prophet Isaiah. After reading, he told the stunned crowd, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Why is this important? F.F. Bruce tells us it was most probably a Hebrew scroll that he received, but even in Palestine, and not least in Jerusalem itself, there were many Greek-speaking Jews, Hellenists, and there were synagogues where they might go to hear the scriptures read and the prayers recited in Greek. The simple fact is, the scroll Jesus read from was a copy of Isaiah, not an original. Also, that scroll he read from was likely from the Greek Septuagint, a translation from Hebrew into the language of the day, Greek. Bottom line, Jesus read from a copy, and likely a translation, and called it Scripture. Jesus didn't think the Bible couldn't be trusted because it was a copy, and he didn't consider Scripture to be mistranslated either. If you question the authority of the Old Testament, you're questioning Jesus' own testimony of God's revelation to us. And again, Jesus made clear that the same Holy Spirit that inspired the Old Testament inspired the New Testament as well. We see how this has transpired, for example, with the woman pouring perfume on Jesus' head, when Jesus said in Mark 14:9, "And truly I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her." Eric Svensson writes, "In this episode, Jesus makes a prediction that makes little sense unless viewed as an anticipation of inscripturation." How then is Jesus' prediction validated? Only by means of inclusion in the New Testament. Jesus must necessarily have been anticipating inscripturation of his words. The 18th century French infidel Voltaire once said that within 100 years of his time, Christianity would be swept away from existence and pass into the obscurity of history. Yet, 50 years after his death, the Geneva Bible Society used his house and printing press to produce stacks of Bibles. I hope this presentation has shown you that we can trust God has given us the entirety of His Word from Genesis to Revelation, and that His Word truly does stand forever. Thanks for watching.